I'm live now. Okay, there is a little bit of delay, but no problem. We can see each other now. Hi, hello. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our first cello lesson collectively. And I hope everybody's staying healthy and safe and practicing a lot of cello. So today I would like to talk to you a little bit about warm-up routines and very simple stuff. A couple of shifting exercises that I prepared to show you guys. And let's start digging into thumb position also. It's gonna be very simple stuff. Open strings, warm-up exercises, and two shifting exercises and one thumb position exercise. Should be done in less than half an hour. Super easy, super practical, and this is something that you can do like throughout the rest of your careers and your lives. It's gonna be very practical. Okay, so let's start with open strings warm-ups. So, why should we do open strings warm-ups? Okay, for two main reasons, and I could say more, but two main reasons. The first one is gonna get your tone in the right place. It's gonna get your tone in the right place. Second is you're gonna improve your overall posture, not only with your right hand and your right arm, but also your posture, your whole body. Because once you are playing open strings, you can identify how your shoulders are behaving, you can pay attention to your elbows, you can pay attention to your wrist movements, and even if you're not playing with your left hand, you can start like thinking about how you're gonna manage and how you're gonna position your left hand and how you're gonna move your arm in the whole compass of the cello, okay? Without further ado, let's start with it. Basically, long notes with open strings. Let's start with our C string. So first of all, what I always like to do is make sure that all my fingers are relaxed. See, they're flexible here. I'm not even start playing. I'm not making any sound on the cello, okay? Now I'm gonna start. Two things to consider when you're playing open strings, long bows and open strings, and how to manage and how to make sure that you are getting the most and the best tone out of your cello. First of all, you need to pay attention to the weight transfer among your fingers. So basically, when you're on the frog, you're gonna start here with your index finger. Then as you move towards the tip, the weight on your hand start here. So it's a little bit crazy because you can start with only this one here, and then you go more, you kind of lean towards the index a little bit more as you go towards the tip. Okay, this is for your first bowing. And then when you go back, you can start using the back of your hand. This huge part of your hand here, full of muscles, full of tissue. Then as you go back, see this part here, the chubby part of your hands, the palm here. This part, you're gonna start using these two fingers and all this thick part of your hand as you go back from the tip towards the frog. So I'm here using this part of my hand, see? My three fingers here, free. And then I start going, balancing my hand towards the back of my hand, my fingers, towards the back of my hand. Then it goes back again. Then these are getting free, and I'm leaning on my index. Now I'm going back again. My index now is free, and I'm leaning towards the back of my hand. And same thing you're gonna do on all strings. G string, same thing. Start here. So this is the first thing to consider when playing opening strings, the weight transfer among the fingers. Second thing is, whenever you reach the extremes of your bow, first here, the tip, when you change directions, and when you change direction here, you need to be aware of how your hands behaving. Basically, the more relaxed your fingers are, the more relaxed your wrist is, you're gonna get a better transition. Your bow change here and your bow change here is gonna sound better, okay? So, oh, what are you saying, Tobias? What I'm saying is, okay, to the tip, G string. So I have my fingers relaxed, I have my wrist in place. There is very little interruption in my sound. Same thing, going back to the frog. Interruption in my sound. And how is that practical in real life, real examples? Let's say you want to play a very legato phrase, whatever that phrase is. So let's play two notes, okay? Here. And let's say that's this B. It's going to be sustained. C major scale. So it doesn't matter where you're playing. If you want to connect, and also it will help you with articulation. Let's say that there is a place where you need a more emphatic articulation, like a more emphatic accent or staccato for that matter. If you have your fingers relaxed here, so this, it's much easier to achieve the right articulation than if you keep your hands stiff and you try to move your bow with your whole arm, okay? So now, the asterisk, the observation towards all these things. Some of you might have observed that when I start here, that my hand is not really pronating towards my index finger, that my hand's kind of resting towards the back of it here. I was like, so how are you gonna use your index finger power if you're resting on the back of your hand? Simple, I'm actually using everything together. However, my index finger here is the one who is kind of giving the orders. So it's leading, my index finger is leading, although I have the weight of my hand and I'm transferring the weight of my arm into the string via the bow. So if I'm here, I have more power, basically. If you wanna play, see, my hand how it's here, it's not here. I'm not pronating for this. I'm here because I want power. Like here, I would play here if I wanted like something fast. See the how I'm pronating here, because this is a fast. Okay, so power, speed. Great. Now, second exercise for open strings when you are warming up. String crossing. I love this one. So here now we talk about, so open strings, just slow bows on open strings. We are talking about fingers and wrist, okay? Now we are going to include our friend elbow, okay? And make sure that throughout everything, I'm wearing a black shirt and I have the back of my chair is black, but shoulders relaxed and down as much as possible, okay? So, string crossing. String crossing, the way I like to approach it is by anticipating the next string which I'm going to. So basically, even if I'm starting on G and going to C, I anticipate the lowest string, I anticipate the next string. So, and why is that useful? So for a couple of reasons. First one is you're gonna smooth the transition from one string to the other. So instead of hitting the next string when you do this huge movement here, you're gonna smooth that out and almost seamless. This is for people who doesn't like bar, but necessary pain that you have to go through. That would would be the most obvious example. One of the most obvious example that you can use this. Okay? So, and then in this example, this exercise is awesome. Especially to do with our friend the metronome. You can go crazy with it. Let's put here 60. And you can count how many changes you're gonna do here. So, that C G G D D A. Awesome. It's gonna clean your sound and always paying attention to how your elbow is gonna anticipate. Okay? So one thing to be very, very, very aware when you're doing this is don't change the string with your wrist. Okay? Especially when you're playing it slow. Okay, make a huge effort, although relaxed, but conscious effort to change, anticipate the string crossing with your elbow. Okay, use the big muscles. When you're playing, this one, let me stop. Okay, you can shut up now. This is another thing, like very general, that you can work on. The slower you play, the bigger the muscles you should engage to play. So as you go playing slower, try to engage your back, your legs, okay? So engage your arm and your forearm, and then you leave your fingers and your wrist for the very small stuff, okay? So, and then, when we are playing fast, we don't use the big muscles? Oh, we use them. But to engage them properly, you need to teach your muscles how to do it. And how we do that? By playing slow and consciously engaging them. Oh, so I'm doing this now, so I'm going to engage this part of my body. So now that I'm doing this, I'm playing the beginning of the Dvorak, I'm engaging my back. Oh, I'm playing the beginning of the Schumann, or the third movement of the Schumann for that matter. I'm engaging my legs because I need to be grounded, and I need power to get this sound across the orchestra, okay? Now, with further ado, I want to talk about shifting, and for that, let me get here the help. Okay, now that I want it, it's not working, of course. Okay, now, yes, it is there. Okay, this is a very simple exercise. I just put it there in notes. I hope everybody can see it. If you can see it, give a print on the string and in the screen, and then copy. Let me get here so you can see my hand. So this is for shifts. What we are doing in this first exercise, we're gonna shift on the sound, okay? So it's a same note shift. What are you talking about? You're gonna change the finger on the same note. So let's start on measure one. So shift. Okay? So basically, all the shifts occurred, they happened inside the same sound. Okay? And I like to do that also with slurred, actually, it's even better. But for the sake of the of just starting this out, you can do that. Just one quarter note per bow and just playing like that. And whenever you have to shift, you do everything that you have to do to shift, but you're gonna shift to the same note. So basically you're playing. Okay, and so on and so forth. So this is the first one. The second one. Okay. I don't want that, but it's okay. There. Awesome. Great. Now the second one. The second one, now we're going to slur everything. And you're going to change finger by finger, okay? So now you're going to change the note but keep the finger. So when we are ascending, we're going to use one for all the shifts. When we are descending, we're going to use three. Or four. Again, one. Okay, so first example, you change fingers, but you keep the same note. The second example, you change note, but you use the same finger. Okay, this is a very, very simple exercise to start mastering your shifts. Okay, you saw that we go from here all the way to 7th, 8th position. Okay, and this is still without the thumb. The thumb here is just accompanying, staying in the right shape. Okay? Now, as I told you, for the last, the pièce de résistance. Yeah. Thumb position. Oh! So, guys, this is something that I've been talking to every one of you individually, and you must do this every day. 3 minutes, but has to be every day, okay? Because this has to do a lot with also conditioning your muscles and creating this nasty callus on your thumb so you can get a better tone out of your cello, okay? Unfortunately, there isn't a way around it. You need to just do it. Just get to the cello and do it. Okay? So, this is a very simple major scale pattern, one octave. X going up and going down. Very simple. Okay? So, we're going to start on the harmonic, the first harmonic of the most strong, let's say, the easiest and strongest harmonic on the cello. That is the octave, okay? And you can do For those playing Popper number one, it's here. Okay? So, major scale, let's start on D. D harmonic, thumb. And just to make sure that we are covering our bases. So, first thing, hand shape, position. I want my thumb to be across two strings so I can play as comfortably as possible a fifth, okay? A perfect fifth. So right now I'm just playing harmonic. But let's say that I want to go crazy and I want to play power chords here. So forth. So that's the first basic thing you need to be careful. Second one, between my thumb and my third finger, I want to have a perfect fourth. So on this string, and you can check the G against the low G. Open string, and same thing with my upper string, A string. I want to have a fourth, perfect fourth, between my thumb and my third finger. And here you can check against your D harmonic. So that's the second thing you need to check when you're playing thumb position. Between your thumb and your third finger, you want to have generally, unless you are on some specific position, but generally, you want to have a perfect fourth, okay? Now, to the third item you need to check when you're playing thumb position, a basic shape, a basic position. So between your thumb on the lower string and your third finger on the higher string, okay, you're playing two strings at a time. You want to have a perfect octave. Okay? This is going to be very important, okay? You have octaves on Sun Cello Concerto. You have octaves on Dvorak Cello Concerto. You have octaves on Bach Suites. You have octaves on sonatas, Brahms Sonata. You have octaves on Shostakovich sonata. So this is very important. Very, very important. Shostakovich cello concerto for that matter as well. So here, now. First one, fifth, fourth, octave. Now let's play the scale. Major scale, one note at a time. Once you play that one note at a time and it's very comfortable, start going, incrementing, okay? Improving that. So let's do two notes. And the objective here is move along all the compass of the cello with the same thing. It's a major scale, one octave. So let's go up a little bit more. So let's go up a half step. D sharp or E flat. And just to make sure that all my parameters are correct. So fifth. fourth octave, and then the scale. Let's go up another half step. E natural. So let's check again. So fifth, fourths, octave. Now the scale. Now back to D natural, harmonic. Let's go back like two half steps. Two more half steps. Okay, so a couple of observations here. So the first one is don't force your sound here. Play as if you're playing open string, okay? Do not try to apply more pressure on the bow just because you're playing on thumb position, okay? However, the place where your bow stay in contact with the string, either closer to the fingerboard or closer to the bridge, that's gonna make a huge difference. The closer to the bridge you get, the better, the more defined, the more full your sound will be for thumb position. This is like very important. Second thing, the same way that I don't wanna press hard with my bow, you cannot, you shall not, you must not press hard with anything on your left hand, especially the thumb, okay? Especially the thumb. So it should be able to work just getting it against the string without any pressure, no pressure. So yes, that's why you need to build up the callus here. So because the skin here is gonna be so rough that just because it's in contact with the string, it stops the string without any extra effort. So that's what you're looking for. And I'm saying, oh my God, Bonemias, you are this huge tall guy and you have like these thick arms and stuff, so for you it's easier. No, don't take this from me. So I took this from two other teachers that I had who were like much smaller than me and half my size. So this is not weight bodybuilding and it is not weightlifting. It's art, it's music. It's supposed to be delicate, it's supposed to be refined, okay? So it's not about being strong. We are not looking for the strongest cellists. We are looking for people who can make beautiful music and, you know, convey emotions and make people laugh and cry. Let's make people laugh, not cry, okay? So that's what you're looking for. So there's nothing to do with strength. It's being smart. Teach your body how to approach the cello, and then you're gonna be fine for sure. Okay. So today we covered open strings, warm up, long bow, open strings, then beware, weight transfer. Okay, among fingers, then changing directions, relaxing here, the wrist, on the tip and on the frog. The second one, string crossing, elbow, anticipate the movement with your elbow, keeping your wrist and your fingers relaxed. Okay, third one, shifting. Remember, shifting on the same note, changing fingers. And the second shift, on the same note, changing fingers, and then keeping the same fingers and changing notes. Okay? And thumb position, one octave, major scale, thumb here. So fifths, fourths, octave, and then move along calmly, okay, on your whole compass of your cello. You can do this all in 5 minutes. If you discipline yourself to do that 5 minutes every day, by the end of 30 days, you're gonna be, I assure you, a better cellist, okay? This is gonna help you play Sansan Cello Concerto. This is gonna help you play any of the six suites of Bach. It's gonna help you play Lalo Cello Concerto. It's gonna help you play Haydn Cello Concerto. It's gonna help you play Elgar Cello Concerto, first movement, Gabi. It's gonna help you play Piari Capricci. It's gonna help you play any of the proper etudes, okay? So, for our next collective lesson, I wanna hear you guys and see what you're gonna hear for next one, okay? Have a nice Sunday, everybody. Stay healthy, stay sane. Bye-bye.